Hi, my name is Emily, and in this video, we'll be going over how to derive the interfaces for stacks and queues. So we've already talked about stacks and queues at a high level in a previous video, so if you need some revision, please go see that video. And also, Alex has made some nice videos on abstract data types, so if you need some revision there, we also have those videos for you. So before we use stacks and queues, we need to have interface functions for them, since stacks and queues are abstract data types. So for any user using stacks and queues, they don't need to know how stacks and queues are represented, they just need to know about the previously agreed upon operations for stacks and queues. So the first thing we need to do is type def the structs that represent stacks and queues as pointers. Since the user doesn't need to know what's inside the struct, they just need to have a reference to it. So we have type def struct stack stack t. So in this notation, stack t is a pointer to a struct stack. After that, we add the functions that we agreed upon previously. So we said that when we add things into a queue, we enqueue and dequeue. So we want these functions as well. With an enqueue function, nothing happens, so we don't need any return type, it's void. However, with a dequeue function, we want to remove an item and return it to the user, so our return type is an int. Similarly, we have our pop and our push. So we have our push and our pop, which are the corresponding ones for stacks, and the return types are similar for the same reasons. And after that, we need to give the users some way of creating a stack, since they can't just push something onto some random stack they pulled out of thin air. So we have these create functions, which will malloc all the items needed. It will malloc the actual struct stack and return a pointer to it for the user, and it will also malloc all of the items inside that the struct and initialize all of the fields to its initial values. And after that, we have to make sure that we give the user some way of destroying that stack, because with our stack T and our QTs, we need the structs to be accessible from many different functions. So we know that at one point we need to malloc them. However, the user can't just call free on QT or free on stack T because they don't know what's inside the structs. There might be a linked list in there or a mallocked array. So you also need to free those items before freeing the actual stack T and QT pointers. So that's why we have other functions, the free functions there, so the user can call these functions, and your job as a coder is to make sure everything inside the struct is freed first, and then you free the pointer to the struct. After that, we have to think about what happens if we try to remove an item from an empty ADT. So with queues, if we try to dequeue an item from an empty queue, we might not know what's going to happen. One thing that we could do is to have this return value be also an indicator value. So we can say if all of our elements are positive integers and our return value is negative, then that means the queue is empty, dequeue did nothing, and that's just an indicator value so the user knows what happened. That's not too great, however, because then you have to restrict your data values to only positive integers, and you can't use negative integers, otherwise you won't know if it's an element that you dequeued or an indicator. So another way would be to use an assert to check for the condition that the queue or the stack is empty. Remember, asserts cause a program to crash if the condition fails. So this is good if you're debugging, because then you know if any error occurs, you won't be allowed to go any further, and you'll know exactly where the error occurred. However, it's not good in production because the user might be typing something in, interacting with the stack and queue, and then all of a sudden it crashes, and then they'll have to rerun the program and be very careful about avoiding whatever they did that caused the program to crash. So a better idea would be to add these functions that allow the user to check if the stack or the queue is empty. So in that way, when you're designing your program that lets the user interact with a stack and queue, you can always call this function to check if the stack or queue is empty before you call your pop or your dequeue. And if it is empty, you can print out a helpful error message instead of causing the program to crash. So the user will never get into that situation where they crash the program because they tried to dequeue from an empty queue. And after that, we have a few functions that make our life a little bit easier when coding. The first one is the front or the peak function. So think about if you're using a queue, a lot of times you just want to know what's at the front of your queue without actually removing it. But with our functions that we've defined previously, in order to do this, you have to first dequeue the element, look at what the element is, and then you want to put it back into your queue. But when you enqueue, remember with queues, enqueue goes to the back of the queue. So if you want this element to be back at the front, you have to dequeue everything and shift it all over until your element is back at the front. So that's really complicated and time-consuming. So an easier way is to just add a front function, which returns the element at the front of the queue without removing it. And something similar for stacks is this peak function. With stacks, if you want to see what's at the top of the stack, you could simply just pop it off, look at what it is, and then push it back on. It doesn't really mess up the order as much as it does with queues, but it's also still an unnecessary operation. So that's why we have a peek, so you can peek onto the top of the stack. The other ones that are useful are size functions. So this is useful if you just want to know how many more items you have left to process, or if you want to change your behavior depending on the size of the queue or the stack. And the last one is something you will love to have when debugging. So this show function just prints out some kind of representation of the queue or the stack to your standard output, so you can make sure that everything in your queue and in your stack is indeed in the right order. So there you have it. These are our interface functions for stacks and queues. You want to define them in your .h file so that any users using your stack and your queue know how they can interact with it. Remember, users only have a pointer to the stack and queue, since they don't know what's inside the struct, so you have to make sure you have a lot of helpful interface functions so that they can interact effectively with the stack and the queue. So if you want to learn more about how to implement these functions, please watch my next video on the implementation for queues, and Matthew has videos on the implementation of stacks.